Hello and welcome to this episode of the Geoeconomic Agenda, a podcast from the Institute for Geoeconomics at the Asia-Pacific Initiative in Tokyo that investigates the connections between economics, geopolitics, business, and society. I'm your host, Paul Nadeau, and I'm a visiting researcher here at the IOG. In a few minutes, we'll talk to Professor Kristin Vekasi of the University of Maine, home to the two-time national ice hockey champion Black Bears, about the past, present, and future of export controls. But first, here's the latest news from the world of geoeconomics. In a joint statement released on May 19th, leaders at the G7 summit in Hiroshima, Japan, agreed to launch the Coordination Platform on Economic Coercion, intended to improve the G7's collective assessment, preparedness, deterrence, and response to economic coercion, particularly on critical goods like semiconductors and minerals. The group also agreed to promote cooperation with partners beyond the G7, particularly on digitization, infrastructure, and trade. The initiative is part of the group's intention to de-risk and diversify away from overdependence on economies like China and Russia. They also emphasized that any response to disruptions would be grounded in maintaining the multilateral trading system with the World Trade Organization at its center. Leaders at the meeting also announced efforts to expand sanctions to target Russia's energy exports and transshipments from third countries. In Detroit, Michigan, on May 26, trade ministers of the APEC member states met in advance of the leaders' summit in San Francisco this November. While no joint statement was issued due to Chinese and Russian objections to language condemning the invasion of Ukraine, a chair statement issued by the U.S. Trade Representative Catherine Tai summarized the discussions. The statement reaffirmed the group's commitment to a free, open, fair, non-discriminatory, transparent, inclusive, and predictable trade and investment environment. Also in Detroit, representatives of the 14 member states of the Indo-Pacific Economic Framework, or IPEF, met on May 27th and agreed to strengthen supply chains for critical minerals and other essential goods to reduce dependence on China. This is the first agreement that the group has reached since discussions were launched in May 2022, and discussions were also held on the trade, fair economy, and free economy pillars. The proposed agreement on supply chains would create an emergency communications channel to facilitate support during a supply chain disruption, as well as improve information sharing and collaboration among IPEF members. The United States also announced several new technological and capacity building steps, such as digital shipping pilot projects, a STEM exchange program, public-private partnerships, and more. The Cyberspace Administration of China, China's top cyberspace regulator, announced on May 22nd that products made by U.S. chipmaker Micron had failed a security review and operators of internet infrastructure in China would no longer be able to buy Micron products. The CAC did not provide details on the reasons Micron failed the review or the specific products subject to the ban. Analysts speculate that business impact on Micron may be limited given that its products are mostly used in consumer goods like smartphones instead of critical infrastructure used by the Chinese government. The announcement came in the midst of the G7 summit in Hiroshima and amongst efforts led by the United States to restrict the availability of advanced chipmaking equipment in China. Finally, the U.S. Congress is considering legislation that would revoke permanent normalized trade relations, also called most favored nation status, with China. Passed in 2000 to facilitate China's entry into the World Trade Organization, Senators Josh Hawley and Tom Cotton have both put forward bills that would revoke PNTR status for China. Described by a trade lawyer as a legitimate policy threat and a potential kill shot in the U.S.-China economic relationship, the White House has said that any legislation revoking PNTR would have a catastrophic effect on China-U.S. relations. And that's the news.
This is the Geoeconomics Agenda with Paul Nadeau.
Today we're sitting down with Dr. Kristin Vekasi of the University of Maine. She's researched economic security and export controls and economic coercion And we're going to talk to her today about Japan's experience on all these issues. Dr. Vekasi, thank you for joining us today.
It is wonderful to be here.
So first of all, 2010, the quote-unquote rare earths embargo. Summarize what happened and, sub-question, was it really an embargo?
Yeah, those are great questions. So this is this really interesting event that happens in the fall of 2010. And it has a non-economic trigger where a Chinese fishing boat captain runs into a Japanese Coast Guard ship in the waters around the disputed Senkaku Islands or Diaoyu Islands in Chinese. In the midst of this dispute, the captain is arrested and brought to Okinawa. The Chinese protest, right? Many people are upset about this. There are nationalist protests and that sort of thing. Japanese companies start to report that they are unable to load rare earths onto ships for export back to Japan. And so this is widely reported in the press. The Japanese government officials start to do surveys of companies, you know, asking, are they able to, are they not able to? Many of the firms report that they are not able to. And this is widely reported as an export ban, and that China is trying to use their control of rare earths in order to coerce Japan into, you know, some sort of change in foreign policy, maybe to release the captain, maybe to, you know, acknowledge Chinese claims to the islands in the more extreme case. But this entire time, top Chinese officials deny that there's any official policy. So this is an early experience with economic coercion, but it's hazy.
That haziness is interesting because I think for a lot of lay people watching this, if you want to get another country to do something, you know, if you want to, quote unquote, coerce them, economic coercion as the case may be, normally you would want to communicate what you want them to do. But that's not what China's doing here. They're maintaining a certain level of plausible deniability. Why, to the best of your knowledge, why do they take that route, instead of just saying, hey, we'll lift this ban if you do this and this and that?
Right. Yeah, that's a great question. So this comes to, I think, one of the big problems at the root of geoeconomics and sort of the way the current state of the global economy, which is at once very integrated, and that integration is important to mutual prosperity of most countries. But at the same time, there's these rising security concerns. So countries, especially trade-oriented countries like China, would like to keep going. Right, that, you know, that globalization is really important. And so burning bridges through a very explicit economic coercion, it doesn't help with broader economic prosperity and development goals. But at the same time, right, there are also these other security and political goals. One of the things that's really important here is that at the time when this happened, Japan got more than 90% of their rare earths from China. But China had also, at the same time, started to implement export limits. And so it is also plausible that the export limit had simply been reached. It was somewhat late in the year. And that was what the Chinese said. I do actually think that there's ample evidence that there was an informal embargo from local Chinese officials. But not from the top, because, again, maintaining the economic relationship was really important for broader policy goals, at least at the time.
So without getting too wonky, if you are a country that wants to impose this kind of economic coercion, and it's not necessarily coming from the top, and it also fits in the context of these broader economic goals, what do you do? Like, how do you reconcile this kind of situation where you're trying to walk and chew gum, where you're trying to embargo Japan, quote unquote, but also make sure that they're a valuable trading partner?
Yeah, so one of the other really big issues and the difficulties of using economic statecraft, especially coercive economic statecraft for any country, China included, but also other countries around the world, is that you can only use it a few times. with a particular product before it might lose its fangs.
Mm-hmm. Before the rest of the world maybe catches on and adjusts, and you know what, next thing you know, at the G7, you're actually talking about this, right?
Right, exactly. So, you know, this, even though this policy was always officially done at the top, the Japanese reacted as if it had been an official embargo. And there was this very heightened sense of risk in the sector that did not necessarily translate to other sectors of the Japanese economy. In fact, it largely did not translate to other sectors. But within rare earths, there was a coordinated set of policies from the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, from the Ministry of Economy, Trade and Industry, as well as from major private sector players to diversify. Mm-hmm. And so starting in 2010, the Japanese government started to subsidize overseas expansion and substitution policies, or research and development to substitution policies, ways to try and reduce the number of materials that were used, all things to decrease dependence on China. And long story short, it worked. and dependence on China went down quite a bit, largely diversified to Australia and Southeast Asia, not just mining rare earths, but along the rare earth supply chain, which is rather complicated. China still is big share of the market, but Japan adjusted,
right.
And so this sort of, this arrow was loosed of this. We have this really powerful tool potentially for coercion for foreign policy goals, and it flew and didn't really hit much of a target, and now it's gone.
And one thing that I think has resulted from China's efforts, and not just the embargo on Japan, but also the measures taken toward Australia, toward South Korea, toward Lithuania, is a greater global awareness of this kind of behavior. And now, as we saw at the G7 and a few other forums, concerted efforts to try to institutionalize a response. This has been about, 13 years since the original incident. So it feels a little too harsh to ask what took so long, but what was the specific moment, if there was one, where the rest of the world beyond Japan said, hey, look, this is a problem and it demands a coordinated response?
Yeah, that's a great question. So I think there are a set of maybe 10 to 20 moments.
Okay.
That right. So we could look at a detailed timeline, which we won't do, but indeed. but so right from the beginning, right from 2010, we start to see multilateral meetings happen. Mm-hmm. And at first they were
from
about,
the very beginning,
right,
almost.
Right from after the embargo. First, Japan and the United States, but then soon Japan, U.S., and some European countries, and then Canada, and then Australia started to have these twice yearly meetings about critical mineral supply chains and technology, and talking about it. There were policy proposals in other countries the entire time, but the sense of risk wasn't as high as it had been in Japan with this direct experience. And I think more than that, there was, particularly in the United States, but also in Australia, there's more of a separation between the business sector and the state sector, maybe a little bit less appetite for interventionism. Mm-hmm. But more than that, there are fewer tools that are already established. So Keisansho, right? Ministry of Economy, Trade and Industry,
right,
had the tools. Say, oh, this is how we do this. We'll try and encourage these. So they were able to respond, I think, a little bit more agilely for that reason. But the second part of your question then is, why are we doing it now? Well, we saw over and over again with the countries you mentioned, but then ordinary people who don't really care about supply chains or economic statecraft saw what happened when you're overdependent with, in Europe and in Ukraine with with natural gas and oil and whatnot. And we saw all of the mess with supply chains in the pandemic. It's like, okay, now is the moment where you can act. Everybody knows
Yeah.
It's supply chain blockages is actually front page news that ordinary people are talking about on the street. And yeah.
As someone who's studied supply chains for a while before the pandemic, mm-hmm. I have to tell you, it was bittersweet to see supply chains making front page news. On the one hand, yes, you want people to be more aware of them, but on the other hand, oh no, not like that.
Yeah.
But okay, turn to the G7 now.
Yeah.
What was just announced? If we had measures like this back in 2010, how might that situation have played out differently?
Yeah, that's a great question. So we have the new coordination mechanisms proposed and more greater. I mean, I think there's a sense that there will be cooperation on trying to build supply chain resiliency. There's also, I think, some sort of mutually contradictory things within the statement and the policies, because different countries have, you know, different interests.
Yes.
So that's reflected as well.
Yeah.
So there's that. And then also in the Indo-Pacific Economic Framework came up with a pretty specific, great critical mineral cooperation framework just in the last week or so. So those two are probably the biggest ones. There are also about 10 other initiatives out there that work on similar things in the region. So just within the Asia Pacific. But if those had existed 10, 13 years ago, I think we could have seen the sort of the full coordination of trying to diversify along the supply chain happen more nimbly and happen more quickly. So the way that it went out, again, without going into the nitty-gritty details,
right,
is that first you have to establish the mining relationship, and there were a lot of failures, and there were some starts and there were stops, and most of the projects didn't work out, and then one did, but then you need to have a processing facility, and so that was negotiated with different countries, and a lot of those projects failed as well, and so all of those pieces now are more in place, this country could do that piece, this country could do that piece. There's different kinds of expertise, there are different strengths, right, different comparative advantages, essentially,
right,
within these different cooperating countries. And those different pieces could come together instead of over the course of 8 years, maybe over the course of 8 months.
Interesting. Sort of going off that point, how complicated, how expensive, how time-consuming is it to diversify a supply chain? And you mentioned Japan did it relatively quickly on rare earths. Is that typical? How often, I mean, I'm assuming it varies from product to product, but how complicated is this whole thing?
Yeah, so right, it definitely varies by product, and it varies by the level of technical expertise you need at different stages, upstream and downstream. And in some of these supply chains, it depends on, so if you think about things that require critical minerals, for example, if they're actually rare or geographically concentrated. So if they are, then it takes a lot more work to diversify a supply chain if diversification is geologically challenging.
Right.
But if the problem is that, you know, the resources were available, but you just didn't do it, then it is easier.
Mm-hmm.
If in the case of rare earths, there's a lot of technical expertise that's needed downstream that we're still working on. So I say, diversification was successful, but the level of technical expertise that's held in the G7 countries compared to China with rare earths is minimal. I mean, they're just really good at it. They've been investing in R&D and students and graduate work and all of this stuff for about 40 years. And, it's paid off.
Well
done. Yeah, really well done.
Yeah.
So that sort of thing, it takes a long time because you need to train your young people up to be geologists and be chemists and be material scientists and right in these fields. So it's a long-term project.
So turning away from China a little bit, because we've been talking about China a lot. China, Russia are not the only countries in the world that engage in economic coercion. You're smirking a little bit. The country I'm talking about is the United States. you know, for reasons good and bad, I don't want to, you know, call them out as, you know, some sort of value added thing, but a lot of countries do this. So if the G7 can put in measures to try to contain economic coercion, then China, Russia, you know, any number of countries could try to do the same. So that's a sort of a long way of saying there could be downside risks or inadvertent risk or backlash, blowback, whatever you want to call it, to these kinds of efforts. And what kind of these kinds of risks do you see potentially facing the United States and other G7 countries at some point?
Yeah, so one of the ways to, if you think about economic security, and this is the way it's often formulated in Japan, certainly, and in the United States, the conversations are a little bit different. But to think about, you know, offensive economic security and defensive economic mm-hmm. security, and mm-hmm. the building supply, trying to build resilient supply chains is presented as defensive. Mm-hmm. But that very act of defensiveness can be seen as offensive by other
point.
Countries. Right?
That's
so,
a very good point.
Logic of the security dilemma. We live in an anarchic world, right? You like, no, I'm just doing this to keep safe myself, but it's seen as, right, threatening.
Sure you are.
Right, sure right. you are, right? Everything's going to be fine.
Yeah.
And I think that dynamic is really clear in US semiconductor restrictions against China, right? Mm. It's presented, maybe thought of even as defensive, but it's certainly perceived as offensive
exactly.
In China. Absolutely,
exactly.
absolutely. Anodyne supply chain, like diversifying your source of, I don't know, masks or something. Mm-hmm. You know, maybe that's what isn't quite as threatening to other countries, but it's still saying, oh, we want to take market share away from you. So if economic prosperity is part of national security, then right, even those actions can be seen as threatening. So if we project, you know, forward and put aside any of the very, very scary war-like futures, mm-hmm. what one of the outcomes I see is just a sort of a very less efficient, inefficient globalization mm-hmm. with more diversified supply chains that sometimes you do things places where, you know, people aren't very good at it yet, mm-hmm. Or it's just more expensive, or you bring things home and you spend a lot more money on them than you would if you were buying them from a foreign market. And maybe that's not the worst outcome. And then, you know, a problem happens and like, oh, well, look, we can respond to this crisis. Mm-hmm. Our supply chain is resilient. We have the chips we need. We have the masks we need. We have the cobalt we need or whatever. But it would be more costly. So there's going to be economic efficiency. Right. Yeah, exactly. So there's trade-offs, but that's a fairly, I'm not responsible to shareholders. So I right. say that's a fine outcome for me, but you know, others may feel differently.
So where do you see this all going next? We probably had the clearest message on this issue from Hiroshima. China, Russia, they're all, you know, logging their reactions. What's the future of this space in the next 3 to 5 years and beyond?
So I see a couple possible futures, depending on a few things that happen. A lot of the language coming out of these initiatives, like the G7, and then also IPEF, the Indo-Pacific Economic Framework, looks at more sort of regionalization or maybe Indo-Pacific. It's a strange region, but right, the localization of some of the supply chains, maybe more like European sort of block-like supply chains is sort of a future you could imagine. So in particular sectors, you would start seeing different blocks of countries mm-hmm. have different integrated supply chains. And then I still would see more sort of broader globalization happening overall, even mm-hmm. when you have that. So it's hard for me to imagine a future where there's still not a lot of integrated trade within Asia that includes China. I don't see that.
You don't envision decoupling.
I don't envision decoupling.
De-risking. Right. Do you envision
right.
that?
So the first thing that I described, where you have these certain strategic
right.
sectors, that's what I see as that seems like de-risking to me. I don't know if the leaders of the G7 would agree that this is the appropriate definition. But that's how I define de-risking. Okay. That you've chosen certain strategic sectors that are core to either your economic prosperity or national security goals, or both, and you have figured out how to do that in a way that you can withstand some sort of nasty geopolitical shock. But the other possible future I see is really a turn towards pushing domestic reshoring, high trade protections, and really nationalistic economic policy. And I think that's a possible future as well.
How likely do you think a future like that might be?
I don't think it's the most likely future, but I think it's a plausible future right now.
Well, I'm sorry to end on an ominous note, but Dr. Kristin Vekasi, thanks so much for joining us today. We really appreciated the time.
Thanks so much for having me.
This is the Geoeconomics Agenda with Paul Nadeau.
Finally, what do U.S. electric vehicles and German beer have in common? Strict local content requirements. You may have heard of the German Reinheitsgebot, literally translated as the Purity Order. While the Bavarian law wasn't the only version of this rule, or even the first, its version of the law from 1516 is the most well-known and the one that was applied nationally in 1906, not long after the unification of the German Empire. And it stipulates that only barley, water, and hops could be used in the production of beer. They assumed the presence of yeast, which is why it doesn't turn up in the 1516 version. Now, while the Reinheitsgebot has come to be synonymous with quality among many quarters, quality wasn't the driving force behind the law. One reason was to avoid a competition between bakers and brewers for grains that might drive up the prices, so the law effectively left wheat and rye for the bakers and barley for the brewers. It also had the purpose of keeping out beers from northern Germany, since they often contained additives or flavorings, and protecting Bavarian beers from potential foreign competition. Even in modern times, and following several adaptations to the law to include yeast and to expand the grains available, along with other adaptations to permit the brewing of certain beer styles, in 1987, the European Court of Justice ruled that the Reinheitsgebot is protectionist and therefore in violation of the treaties governing the European common market. But since the ruling only applied to imported beer, Germany continued to require compliance with the Reinheitsgebot for domestic beer. Today, with international markets for beer and no competition for grains like there were in the Middle Ages, the Reinheitsgebot exists mostly as a tool for marketing and for quality assurance, with many foreign brewers using the expression for certain German-style beers produced overseas. For the United States, so far it looks like local content requirements are being saved for electric vehicles, because if any country could benefit from some strict laws governing what goes into its beers, it's the United States. That's all for this episode, but stay tuned for more on the way. Until then, we want to know what you want to hear about, as well as take your questions for our shows. So send us an email at geoeconomicagenda@ihj.global. Be sure to like, rate, subscribe wherever you get your podcasts, tell your friends, and most of all, keep listening. Thanks for joining us. Thanks to the team at API for making this happen. And we'll talk to you next time.